This is Mid-Atlantic Women in Agriculture's Wednesday webinar, Adverse Possession. Our presenter today is Sarah Everhart with the Agricultural Law Initiative. All archived presentations, along with all upcoming presentations, can be found at our website. And a special thank you to our sponsor, Mid-Atlantic Farm Credit. Since this presentation is pre-recorded, Sarah will be unable to take live questions, but she has provided her email address, and all questions can be sent to her directly. Thanks so much for listening.
Here to talk to you all today about adverse possession, and that is just a legal term for what we commonly refer to as squatter's rights. I need to start with a disclaimer. You have to forgive me. I'm an attorney. It just comes with the territory. But the purpose of today's presentation is just to give you some general information, and it's not individual legal advice. So if you have a situation on your property, and you need to talk to your own individual attorney, today's just to give you some background so you understand the general legal concepts. And this presentation is just for the state of Maryland. So if you have property in a different state, the laws are going to be different. And this particular topic does differ from state to state. So if you're talking about Delaware or Virginia, for example, make sure that you consult an attorney in those states so you get accurate information. Just to explain to you a little bit about where I work and why I'm here talking to you today. I work, as Shannon said, for the Agricultural Law Education Initiative. It is a collaboration between the University of Maryland Law School and the University College of Agricultural and Natural Resources. That's through the University of Maryland College Park campus. So there's a couple attorneys in the program, and our job is to be a legal resource for the agricultural community across the state of Maryland. All right, let's get down to it. What is adverse possession? It's an ancient legal doctrine, and as I said, it's what we commonly refer to as squatter's rights. Even though it's an ancient legal doctrine, it's still quite common in Maryland. Before I started working for the university, I was in private practice for about 9 years, and this is a subject that will come up time and time again. It's also a subject that will come up very often in the agricultural community because it's something that is prevalent on tracts of large acres, such as, you know, wooded areas or farms. Many people with large tracts of land are unsure of the exact location of their property lines. They may have the understanding that a tree line or a boundary that's been observed for many years is their legal boundary, but this is not always the case. This confusion about the actual location of property lines is normally what starts the adverse possession issue. If your neighbor and you mistakenly think that a tree line is your property line, and then your neighbor builds a fence, and that fence is actually enclosing some of your property, that's when we start to get into this issue. That's the most common scenario. So here's just an example to get your head around this. Let's imagine that you and your neighbor are confused about your property lines, and this causes your neighbor to fence in land that's actually part of your farm. Your neighbor proceeds to use this property as if it is his own, and the mistake is not discovered until a survey is done when his child takes over the farm 21 years later. Based on the facts in this example, your neighbor now has a viable claim to own that section of your property that's enclosed by his fence through the legal doctrine of adverse possession. Even though the property was included in your deed, you paid for the land, and you most likely have been paying property taxes for the land, you just lost that acreage to your neighbor. Okay, so that's a scary scenario, and unfortunately one that happens year after year after year in Maryland on farms. So how do we prevent it? The most effective way to prevent adverse possession is to understand what is needed to establish a claim. For a claim of adverse possession to be successful, the person making the claim must show that the possession of the land for the required period of 20 years The possession must be actual, open, notorious, exclusive, hostile, and under claim of title or ownership, and continuous. That's a mouthful. And this legal definition confuses experienced lawyers, so don't be daunted by it. We're going to break it down and take it step by step. To put it in basic terms, in order to claim land by adverse possession, you have to use it for 20 years, and your use must meet these certain criteria. So let's go through them and figure them out. Here's just a little graphic. Hostile, exclusive, actual, continuous, open, and notorious. Actual, open, and notorious. We'll group those together. To be actual, open, and notorious, the use must include some demonstrative indications of use, such as mowing the grass, erecting a building or a fence, or planting crops. I'll repeat this again and again during this presentation, but basically, to be successful for a claim of adverse possession, the person making the claim has to prove that for 20 years, they've used that land as if it was their own. They've used it just like they use the rest of their land. So if it was cropland, they use it to plant crops. If it was just some boundary-type land, land that you do nothing more than mow, that's what they should have been doing for 20 years. The use must be of the variety that would put the true owner on notice that the land is being adversely possessed if he or she happened to walk or drive by. So, the adverse possessor doesn't need to give verbal or written notice to the true owner. The actions of the adverse possessor are sufficient to deliver the notice to the true owner. They just have to be out there using that land on a day-to-day basis or with enough regularity that if the true owner were checking on their property, they would notice that somebody else is actually using it. You don't have to scream it from the rooftops, but you also can't just go out there once a year and, you know, tie a ribbon around a tree. You have to be out there using it with regularity. Okay, for adverse possession for the exclusive use, this one is a legal term that trips up many people. To use land exclusively does not require that you guard the acreage day or night, nor does it require that you never let other persons onto the acreage. Rather, it means that you use the land as your own and in a way that a true owner would use it. There's a presumption that the true owner is in possession of the land, and to overcome this presumption, a possessor must show that he or she intends to exclude the true owner. This intent to exclude must be shown by actual visible means so that the true owner has notice. So actually, exclusive use is similar in some ways to the open notorious use that we just talked about. To use it exclusively basically just means that you have to use it as your own and in the way that the true owner would use it. And how would you use land hostily? This one, again, is confusing because it's not your typical meaning for the word hostile. To use land hostile means to use it without permission of the true owner. When there is no evidence of permission and the possessor proves that the other elements of adverse possession have been met, a presumption arises that the possession was hostile. If the true owner can show that the possession was pursuant to his or her permission, the presumption of hostility is rebutted and the claim is defeated. This is important, and I think I have an example of this next. Yeah, here we go. But we can just talk about this for a second. Hostile use and permission. Permission is a very important concept when it comes to adverse possession. If you ask your neighbor for permission to use part of his property, such as if let's say your neighbor has a dock with some water access, and you want to be able to use that dock to access the water, and you ask your neighbor and he says sure, and you go ahead and use that dock for 20 years and maybe you decide to build some kayak racks or a boathouse, improve the property, you cannot have a claim for adverse possession because that use was based in permission. If it was based in permission, it's not hostile. Hostile use is when you just go on somebody's property and take it over. You haven't gotten anybody's permission. You've just gone on, taken a piece of property, and used it as your own. Okay, and this is another phrase that's sometimes in the definition, to use land under claim of title or ownership. For example, if you want to install an orchard partially on your neighbor's property and you seek his approval before the beginning of the project, the planting of the orchard cannot form the basis of an adverse possession claim because it was done with express permission. That's similar to the dock example I just gave you. To use land under claim of title or ownership simply means that you use the land as if you had actual title to the property. So if you actually thought you had a deed to the area where you wanted to install the orchard, to act under claim of title or ownership, you would proceed to install the orchard instead of first asking for your neighbor's permission before you commence the project. There's lots of cases about permission and how permission plays into the theory of adverse possession. Maryland courts have held that if permission is granted at the beginning, permission is implied to remain throughout the course of the use. So let's say that grandpa gave your father permission to use the property 15 years ago, and then you've carried on with that use. That permission still exists, and that permission is still going to prevent the claim from adverse possession. So you have to be very careful with that. And here's just that graphic and a little review of the elements so we make sure we understand them again. Hostile, without permission. Exclusive, actual, continuous, open, notorious. You have to go onto somebody's property. You have to take over. You have to use the property in an open, continuous way for 20 years in order to have a claim for adverse possession. Now, the burden of proving the elements of adverse possession is on the person making the claim, and the determination of whether the claim is sufficient is a fact-specific inquiry. This means that every situation is analyzed by the courts and depends on the facts of the situation. So this really is not a cookie-cutter legal standard. This legal standard has been pulled apart and analyzed and continue to be analyzed by all levels of Maryland courts every year. The Maryland courts have held that something more than mere occasional use of the land is needed, but the type of use depends on the character and location of the land. The type of usage necessary to adversely possess a parcel in a residential subdivision is much different than the type of usage necessary to adversely possess a piece of rural property. So here's two cases I'll explain to you, but the point of this, me telling you about these two cases and understanding this concept is just what I was just explaining in that last slide. It's a fact-specific inquiry, each case, and it really revolves, the whole issue turns on the type of land that is being adversely possessed. So if you're talking about adversely possessing a piece of woodland out in the country somewhere, a scrubby piece of property, that's going to be a much different scenario and require much different types of uses than an empty lot in the middle of a town. Here's a case, Blickenstaff v. Bromley. The Maryland Court of Appeals, which is the highest court in Maryland, found that the Blickenstaffs, who were claiming title by adverse possession to a small parcel of scrubby brushland adjacent to a farm, met the legal standard for adverse possession through their actions of clearing brush, cutting bean poles, felling large trees, and planting and maintaining a flower bed on the property for the requisite 20-year time period. So that's all they did. They didn't fence anything in. They didn't build any structures. All that the Blickenstaffs did was for 20 years, they used that small parcel of scrubby brushland adjacent to a farm in those specific ways, cutting bean poles, felling large trees, planting and maintaining a flower bed. After doing that for 20 years, the property was theirs. By contrast, in Barkowski versus Silver Farms, Inc., the Maryland Court of Special Appeals held that the mere occasional use of a lane for walking, horseback riding, picking up branches, and chasing off trespassers was insufficient to be the exclusive, open, and notorious type of use necessary to sustain a claim of adverse possession. I give you these two examples because to me they don't seem too terribly different. I think that the difference that the courts drew on these two was that if you had, let's take that Barkowski example, if you had some folks who occasionally used a lane on your farm for walking, horseback riding, and they occasionally picked up some branches out there, that might not be the kind of use that would put you as the true owner on notice. However, if your neighbors were the Blickenstaffs and they were out on a piece of your property and they were planting and maintaining a flower bed, cutting down trees, those are more of the types of visible uses that you as the true owner would notice, and that you should see, the true owner should be put on notice that someone is adversely possessing at that point. Okay, how to prove the 20-year statutory period. Well, it's easy if one owner has continuously used another's property for the 20-year statutory period. It's satisfied, that's easy. But what if the current owner has only owned the property for 15 years? Can a claim of adverse possession be made? When no single adverse possessor has held the property for the statutory period, successive periods of adverse possession may be tacked together to meet the required time frame. This is what we call tacking. You can tack together the 20-year statutory period. So, I have an example here at the bottom we'll get to in a second. Tacking is only permitted when the time periods to be tacked or combined consist of the use from the previous owner and the next successive owner of the property without a break in use. When the successive owner receives the property being adversely possessed must either be included in the deed or be adjacent to the property he is receiving and described as being part of the property. So here's an example. Let's say owner A uses a portion of property between his barn and a hedgerow for 18 years. Then he decides to sell his farm to owner B. In so doing, owner A explains to owner B that the farm includes the area between the barn and the hedgerow. When owner B discovers 3 years later that the property line for the farm actually ends at the barn, he will be able to tack the years of adverse possession of owner A onto his years of adverse possession to meet the statutory period. So because that adverse possession started with owner A explained to owner B that that portion of the property between the barn and the hedgerow was part of the farm he was buying, and owner B continued the use without skipping a beat, and the use continued for 20 straight years, then the requisite period was met. So it can be met by more than one person. You can tack together more than one period. You just have to make sure that those elements are met. There just can't be a break. And the one thing to mention, the fact that the adverse land must be included in the deed, this does happen. Deed descriptions are repeated, deed after deed after deed after deed. They can contain many errors, and a lot of times a mistake is just carried through owner after owner. So your best bet if you're buying a piece of property and you're unsure of the property lines is to get a survey done, because a surveyor is the only one who's going to be able to tell you where your true property lines are. Okay. Adverse possession, how title is acquired. So if you believe you have the basis for an adverse possession claim to property, you must file a lawsuit in the circuit court in the county in which the property is located. And you'd be asking the court to quiet the title to the property. Quieting title means that the court decides the lawful owner of the property. Once a court has ruled in your favor, you can amend your deed to include the adversely possessed property. I just thought I would include that in this presentation. It's kind of complicated for non-legal folks to understand what all these terms mean, and I just want you to understand that even if you have been using property for 20 years, although you might have actually met the legal requirements for adverse possession, you still need to go through a legal process before your deed can be amended to include that property. Okay. How to prevent an adverse possession claim. What if you discover that for the last 10 years, your neighbor has been planting a row of crops on your farmland? What should you do? Well, first thing you should do is not ignore it for everything you've heard so far in this presentation. To prevent an adverse possession claim, you must assert your claim as the true owner to the land, either through physical reentry or by taking some action to reinstate your possession. This means either demanding that the planting ceases or establishing a leasing relationship with your neighbor. You know, I'm not here to advocate you becoming an evil neighbor. As I've explained, most of these adverse possession claims are based in confusion. 9 times out of 10, this isn't a situation where a neighbor is being spiteful and is out to purposefully steal your property or squat on your property. 9 times out of 10, this happens when a neighbor makes a mistake and puts his fence in the wrong location or plants his crops in the wrong location. However, that being said, you need to do more than just have a conversation with your neighbor across the fence. You need to take action because you need to stop that clock from running. So something as simple as establishing a leasing relationship with your neighbor would do that. If you obviously you don't want your neighbor to have the you don't want your neighbor to have the loss of those crops, and if it's actually not really, you know, interfering with your operation that year, just enter into a simple lease with your neighbor, and that puts everybody on the right footing, because in that situation you're the true owner and you're giving permission. So what if you discover that your neighbor's barn is built partially on your property? Perhaps the location of the barn doesn't actually bother you, but you don't want to risk your neighbor asserting a claim for adverse possession, which could reduce your total acreage. One easy solution would be to send your neighbor notice that his barn is on your property with your permission. This action is evidence that his use of your property isn't hostile, but rather done with your express permission. This happens more often than you would ever imagine. People build outbuildings on other people's property all the time. When you go down to the county to get your building permit, they don't actually know where your legal property lines are. So if you show them a sketch and tell them, here, I want my building permit, I'm going to put up a pole building, this is where I'm going to put it, they'll give you that building permit, and unless you've had a survey done, nobody knows where your actual property lines are. So this happens a lot. And making sure you get something in writing stating that that building is there with your permission, and that if that building ever comes down or is lost to fire or something like that, it can't be rebuilt, that's all that you need to do. That will maintain your total acreage. That's something an attorney should be able to put together for you. So if you have that situation on your property now, go see an attorney and ask them to draw something like that up. Okay. Does anybody have any questions about what I've gone over with adverse possession before I move on to easement by prescription? I'm going to keep barreling through. Easement by prescription, but please feel free to just throw something in the chat box if you have a question. An easement by prescription is a very similar legal concept to adverse possession. If you understand what we've gone through today on adverse possession, you'll understand easement by prescription. An easement is a non-possessory interest in real property, or put another way, it's the right to use another's property without actually owning the property. So that's the difference between easement by prescription and adverse possession. In adverse possession, you're actually going to come out on the other side owning 10 acres of somebody's property. If you meet all the elements of easement by prescription, you're going to come out with the right to use somebody's property, but not actually own somebody's property. A prescriptive easement is basically adverse possession of a right-of-way, and it arises when a party makes an adverse, exclusive, and uninterrupted use of another's real property for 20 years. When a person has used a right-of-way openly, continuously, and without explanation for 20 years, the Maryland courts have held it is fair to presume the use is adverse. The same legal concepts which apply to adverse possession apply to easements by prescription. and that the true owner must take proactive steps to stop the adverse use of a right-of-way, or else the use can form the basis of a claim for an easement by prescription. Although disallowing a neighboring farmer to use a right-of-way may not seem like the neighborly way to act, once a prescriptive easement has been acquired, the easement will run with the land and can have serious repercussions on the future development potential and land value. So this is, I bring up easement by prescription because it's sort of the sister concept to adverse possession, and because this is another legal concept that comes up a lot on farms. As we all know, many farmers share right-of-ways. You know, many farms are set back far from the public road, so there's a lot of old farm lanes and right-of-ways on farms, and there's a lot of history allowing certain owners to drive, you know, over other farm lanes to get to the main road. You have to be careful letting other people use right-of-ways that are on your property. If somebody has used a right-of-way on your property without permission for 20 years, they have the basis to claim that they have an easement by prescription to use that, which means they have it, and it's now part of their deed. So any other future owners of that property would also have it. So if you have a farm and you're thinking, you know, I don't know how much longer we're going to keep a hold of our farm, maybe eventually we're going to sell a portion of our farm for development if we ever needed to, subdivide off a few lots in order to keep the general operation going. And any of that could be affected by your neighboring property owner asserting a claim to use a right-of-way. This is where the concept of easement by prescription comes in handy. You need to understand this. Here's a little visual that I found helpful, and this is a typical scenario. You can see Abel's property. Abel actually has access to the highway by using that road along the left-hand side of his property. But actually, you know, what he's done for 20 years is he's driven across Baker's property to get to the highway. That's just what he's done. It hasn't bothered Baker. That's just been their course. That's what they've done. They've been good neighbors. They've never talked about it. Baker never gave permission, but Abel's been doing it, and he's been doing it with regularity. Well, Abel now has a claim to that easement being a part of Abel's property perpetually into the future. So when Abel goes to sell his property, he's going to include that easement in his real estate deal, and that easement's going to cross Baker's property for the foreseeable future. This is an interesting case that I thought I would share with you all. Okay, so we know the elements of easement by prescription because they're the same as adverse possession. There was a recent case, 2006, I guess not so recent, but pretty recent. It was an adult son who lived on a farm as a minor, and he brought an action against the farm's current owners claiming prescriptive easement for a right-of-way across the farm. The Court of Appeals found a presumption of adverse use does not arise in favor of a person when that person begins to live jointly with and on his or her parents' property as a minor and then continues to live on the property along with his or her parents as an adult. What happened was is that the son lived on his family farm. The family then sold the farm to new and independent buyers. The son then claimed easement by prescription, using the period that he had used the right-of-way when he was on the property as their child, as a member of the family, saying that he never asked anybody for permission, and therefore he should be able to use that period towards his easement by prescription, because he didn't ask anybody for permission, he used the right-of-way, and he continued to use it when the new owners bought it, and he wanted to tack the period together to get to the 20 years. Shockingly, I thought that this was pretty shocking, the Circuit Court and the Court of Special Appeals both agreed with the son. Luckily, the Court of Appeals overturned it and found that to rule otherwise would create serious problems for elderly farmers who had farmland and included their children in their farming operations. Because, if this case had gone the other way, a farmer's ability to sell his land could be compromised by children who allege that they have lived with their parents, not by permission, but by mere acquiescence. So anyway, this is just an example of how, even though these are old legal doctrines, they're still very much fresh, and they're still happening all the time. These issues are all around us, and people are still trying to get creative about how to implement them. I thought this guy and his attorney were very creative, saying that he had used that right away without his parents' permission, and therefore he should get an easement by prescription. Made it all the way up to the highest court before he was told no. Okay, so adverse possession. What have we learned? What is important to take away? I think a really important thing to take away is just don't let your property boundaries be affected by inattention or inaction. Figure out where your actual property lines are and keep an eye on them. I mean, I know it sounds like a silly, overly general thing to say, but I mean, it's true, and it's especially an important thing to do when you have a large tract of property, because a little bit of inattention can lead to a big problem pretty quickly. Make sure that no one else is using your property in a way that could form a claim for adverse possession or an easement by prescription. Make sure that you're neighbor's flower bed is actually on your neighbor's property and not on your own. Make sure that outbuilding is actually on his property and not on your own. And if it's on your own, do something about it. And if your property is being used, take action to stop the clock from running. You have to do something to reassert your true ownership of that property. So I would go see an attorney and figure out whether you want to set up a leasing relationship, whether you just want to send a letter asserting the fact that they're using your property by permission, or, you know, what you need to do to reassert your true ownership of that property. Okay, well, here's my contact information. There's my email. There's our website for the Agricultural Law Education Initiative and my phone number. If anyone has any other questions about this, they can, you know, put something in the chat box now or shoot me an email. Our program is fairly new. We have a blog, so if you go onto this website, you can sign up for our blog, and we cover topics like this, agricultural legal topics. Then you can read our blog posts. We usually post about 3 a week, and you know, we'll help you stay up to date with current issues and just general issues that are of interest to you, such as labor, estate planning, right to farm, a whole host of things. And we love to hear from people in the farming community, because you all are the ones that have these issues, and we need to know what we need to be writing about and educating about and what's the most help to you.
Thank you for watching our archived presentation of our Wednesday webinar. If you would like to see more archived Wednesday webinars, please visit our YouTube channel. Or to find a schedule of upcoming live webinars, visit our website.